You are now in a world.
It's the Death of Richie, the special edition. The Death of Richie is a 1977 made-for-TV movie, and now, with the Death of Richie Special Edition, now out on Blu-ray and DVD, you can watch the Death of Richie as it was originally meant to be. Gone are all of the old and outdated scenes of a young man struggling with a drug addiction, and in its place is the scene at the end of La Bamba where actor Isai Morales calls out for his brother. It's the Death of Richie Special La Bamba Edition. Gone are Robbie Benson, and in its place, 1 hour and 35 minutes of Isai Morales yelling for Richie. That's all it is, just Isai Morales yelling for Richie. Do you like seeing Mexicans yell for their dead brother? Of course you do. And now with the Death of Richie, the special edition, you can watch 1 hour and 35 minutes of Isai Morales yelling for his brother. That's right, Isai Morales. Richie! It's the Death of Richie, the special edition.
Daddy has Latino heat.
Welcome to the Pope on Film. I am Bunny Williams, and with me is
Reverend Steve. I am the founder of the Church of Ed Wood, and this podcast will exist in the flowers, in the trees, and in all the things of nature that God has given us.
Yes.
And somewhere, sometime, we will join you. And I'm doing this to save my son.
And another perfect example of why Richie's dead.
Yeah. Richie's dead because of society, man.
Yeah.
And also the drugs. Two things killed Richie. Society and Clint Howard.
Clint Howard.
Yeah.
That should have been enough. Like, no, you're not hanging out with that kid.
Yeah.
I don't care if he goes to church. Just you're not hanging out with that kid.
I don't care that his nickname is Peanuts.
Yeah.
His nickname was only that because he was a really big fan of Race for Your Life, Charlie Brown.
Yeah.
He was just such a huge Charles Schulz fan that they called him Peanuts.
Did you get a chance?
Schulz.
Did you get a chance to listen to the Mr. Lobo episode?
I have it on my phone. I was going to listen to it the next time I drove, but I've been on I did a long drive to work, but I've been on a bit of a vacation, so no, I have not. Good. I've been on a slight vacation. We were going to go to Six Flags over Tejas, but we were interrupted by Tropical Storm Bill. So in a sense, Bill Cosby raped our vacation plans.
as he did so many.
Yes. Yes, we are yet another victim of Bill. He got our vacation plans and just said, "Here, I've made you a cocktail." Really, really messed up. There's a part of me that's somewhat glad that we didn't go to Six Flags because I'm getting older. It's much easier for me to get dizzy now.
Yeah.
You know, it's easier to get dizzy. I'm not much of a rider anymore like I used to be. Like in my teens and 20s and even early 30s, I was a really good roller coaster rider. Now, not so much. Not so much.
Yeah.
Not exactly sure. It's just that getting older sort of thing. Like a couple of years ago, we went to the state fair and the kids wanted to ride the, what's the name of that spinning ride? I know that describes every ride at the fair. No, no, no. The teacups are only at Disneyland. So no, at the state. No, Emerald, not the Gravitron, the Tilt-A-Whirl. Thank you, honey. The Tilt-A-Whirl. We went on the Tilt-A-Whirl, and I said, okay, I'll go with the kids. And it made me vomit.
Ah.
The Tilt-A-Whirl. And then I said, oh, well, I guess I can't really ride the Viper next time I go to Six Flags if the Tilt-A-Whirl has laid me out.
So yeah. Okay. But yeah. Okay. But look at it this way. Okay.
Yeah.
You can ride the Tilt-A-Whirl and get sick. Or you can ride the Viper and get sick. Either way, you're sick, but with the Viper, you're getting more bang for your buck there.
That's a good point.
You will have, you get off the Tilt-A-Whirl and you vomit, you feel kind of a little bit like a pussy, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Get off the Viper and vomit, you fucking earned that vomit. That's a vomit you can be proud of. That's a vomit you can name and send to college.
Nice. I don't know. I'm just getting older. There's a part of me that, you know, we drive past a golf place. What was the name of that golf place we passed the other day? Golf Galaxy. We passed Golf Galaxy. It's a golf superstore. And I said, I'm not there yet, but something tells me that eventually I'll just have to give up and play you. But I'm not there yet. Because there are steps to getting older.
Yes, yes,
that
there
is
are.
A step.
Many, many
I was
steps.
I forgot to tell you about this, but I checked my email. What was it? Yesterday? Two days ago? Yesterday. I checked my email 2 days ago. I hardly ever check my email. I check it once in a blue moon. But I said, let me check my email. And a couple of hours before, I got an email from a producer of a show on MTV.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, they do this documentary series over there, and they're doing an episode on I started my own religion.
Okay.
And so they want to have me on their show. Cool. But it's a documentary-style show, so I guess they would be coming over here and following me for a day or two.
Possibly.
I'm not sure, because I talked to the producers and I told the producers that I was game, and now they have put me in the running for the show now officially. Now I will be contacted in a couple of days by the casting agents to see if I'd be a good candidate for the show. The thing is that it's MTV and I'm 38, so I'm pretty sure it's not going to happen.
Okay, yeah.
Because I'm already too old to be on any MTV show. I looked up some information about the show.
With everything that happened with Caitlyn Jenner and religions based on Ed Wood.
That's a good point. My wife says that they might have me on just because of everything that's happened with Caitlyn Jenner. And I do have a Ed Wood The producer did specifically say that my out of all the people who they have talked to who have started a religion, that my idea that I was the most successful.
Nice.
Which I guess is right. I mean, I've been doing this since 1996, so I, you know, 10 points for Gryffindor, but I'm just feel like I'm a bit too old. It probably won't happen, but I just wanted to mention I am in talks with the MTV people.
Well, that's always like the attitude to have, you know?
Yeah.
Like I've had people offering me money to direct a movie and stuff like that, and it's bullshit, you know?
Yeah.
And maybe something isn't bullshit, but you just got to be like, okay, that would be cool if it happened, but now I'm just going to go on with the rest of my life.
Yeah.
You know?
It's all bullshit until proven otherwise.
So as an example, we were talking about possibly doing the Lessons of Wood as a web series, and Mr. Lobo is talking about possibly putting it on his channel.
Yeah.
You know? But we were already talking about doing it anyway, you know, in one way or another.
Yeah.
So it's just like, okay, well, that's nice. That's really nice. And if that happens, that would be awesome. But now, let's just put that out of our heads.
Yeah.
And just see about doing it.
Yeah. We're doing this whether or not this thing that we end up doing appears on a TV station or not.
Right.
It's just going to happen. Yeah, that's... Like, I'm going to just keep doing my thing, and if they want to have me go somewhere or follow me around, okay, that's fine.
Yeah.
It's exciting to say, though.
Yes, it is.
Like, hey, guess what, ladies?
yes, it was.
I'm in talks with a little place called MTV. Ladies.
Yeah, and things come along like that once in a while that are really kind of a big charge. Like, a couple of years ago, one of my Facebook friends had posted this thing about this girl who, she had some kind of sickness, whatever. She wasn't attractive, and she wanted to be a zombie on The Walking Dead. So please share this so she can get on The Walking Dead. One of these kinds of things.
Yeah.
But he said he checked it out and it was for real and, you know, whatever. Well, I had gone to like a group meeting of filmmakers, and I met the second unit director of The Walking Dead there. I also met their sound guy.
Yeah.
So I emailed him. And he responded, and he was like, sounds interesting, I'll pass it on to the producers. Look, okay.
Huh.
I mean, it's nothing much of a story, but it's just like...
Yeah.
Yeah. So now if that girl is on The Walking Dead, I am in there somehow. You know?
Yeah. Understand.
So now for a complete non sequitur.
Yes.
Have you seen The Devil's Rejects?
Yes, I saw House of a Thousand Corpses and The Devil's Reject.
Okay, so I'm finding I need to call bullshit on one of the scenes in The Devil's Rejects.
I watched The House of a Thousand Corpses so that I could watch The Devil's Rejects, and the only reason I watched The Devil's Rejects is because that's how great Diamond Dallas Page was back in the day.
Yeah.
Like, what? Diamond Dallas Page is in this movie? Okay, I'll see the first one so I can see the second one, because that's how much I like Diamond Dallas Page, because he was amazing. I love Diamond Dallas Page.
Yeah. Yeah, he was fun.
But
there's a scene where they're talking about fucking a chicken.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm aware of this scene. Yes.
So now, from the instructions that we were given in this movie, you take the chicken, you put your cock in the chicken, Then you cut the chicken's head off. I don't believe that that is actually possible to do.
Well,
first you got a chicken, which is not the calmest animal in the world.
True.
Okay. Then yes. You stick your dick in it, which is probably going to make it a little excitable.
Okay, yes.
And now you are holding this very excited, fearful chicken with one hand while you cut off its head with the other?
Okay, yeah, that doesn't seem possible.
I would bet
that
9 times out of 10, that results in you dropping the chicken and then having to chase after the chicken with your pants around your knees.
Probably, yes. I would probably say that would be the likely outcome.
Yeah.
But I will not be testing any of that out. So I guess I just kind of assumed that they had fact checkers or whatever on the set. That they had their sources, you know.
Yeah, no. That's not how you fuck a chicken. That's not how you fuck a chicken. We're going for accuracy here.
Yeah.
We have the chicken fucking experts over here.
Yeah, can we get one of the experts over here? We go, yes, let me show you the blueprints.
See, now that's the next stage of getting old, when you're just kind of sitting here not doing anything much in particular, and you're like, hey, I don't think you can fuck a chicken like that.
Yeah, that... Like, I have a hard time watching Jurassic Park now because there's just so many holes in Jurassic Park.
Yeah.
And it's like, okay, well, no. Wait a second. That can't happen. That sort of a thing.
Yeah.
Oh, Jesus Christ. It's as hot as hell over here. It's just so hot.
We're starting to heat up.
Yeah.
We're just like breaking into the 80s, though. But after how cold it's been, it's just like, fuck.
Well, it's a hot, it's a humid hot over here. I'd rather be in a Phoenix 110 than an Oklahoma 95.
Yeah.
Because it's just a more bearable heat. You know?
Yeah.
It's ugh. Everything's all sticky. But not like a good sticky. Like a yucky sticky.
A yucky sticky, yeah. Yeah, it's been hot here and very overcast.
Yeah. Well, before we start with the show, I wanted to make a few corrections from last week.
Okay.
I wanted to make a few corrections. I last week on our last episode of the podcast, I claimed that my daughter Isabella could fit 8 billiard balls in her mouth.
Yes.
Apparently she cannot and almost choked to death. So I wanted to say that she cannot fit 8 pool table balls in her mouth. I also said that Rip Taylor starred in The Last Starfighter. Turns out he did not star in The Last Starfighter.
No.
Rip Taylor was not the star of The Last Starfighter. I also claimed that The Wizard of Oz was the white version of The Wiz.
Okay.
Turns out I had those mixed up.
Uh-huh.
Turns out The Wiz is the black version of The Wizard of Oz. Who knew?
Who knew?
Who knew?
That's the problem with remakes.
I also claimed last week that Pacific Rim was a gritty reboot of the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. Turns out I was wrong about that.
Okay.
Pacific Rim was an original idea. An original idea.
Are you sure? That may bear a little more fact checking.
Yeah, no, I might have to do some more investigating about that. Do you have any corrections from last week? Anything that you said that you need to correct?
No, but I do have something to correct from the other week.
Okay, well, what's that?
Not the Charlie Brown episode. God, a few weeks ago.
The Wet Hot American Summer episode?
The Wet Hot American Summer episode when I so terribly wrongly...
Oh, yes.
...cursed Janine Garofalo for being a false Gen Xer, for being a poser.
Yeah.
For trying to take the lead in a new generation when you didn't deserve it.
Yeah.
I was wrong. I was deeply, sadly, horribly, tragically wrong. It suddenly realized after editing the episode that you had said that she was 50 years old.
Yes.
I am 51 years old. I am the last baby boomer. If you look it up, 1963 is the last year of the baby boomers.
Yeah.
She's a year younger than me. That would have made her the first Gen Xer.
Yeah, my corrections were funnier.
So I remove my curse from you, Janine Garofalo.
Is that all you have to say? Is
go
just
in
I
peace.
Remove the curse?
Well, I'm not gonna fucking apologize for this.
I've never heard someone take a curse back before, so I wasn't sure what the logistics of it was, you know.
Yeah. Well, I follow the old ways, you know, the original path, before all the lawyers got involved, you know, and started adding little riders and shit to the curse and like,
yeah,
you know, all that just fucking mess. Yeah, it's over. It's done. Janine, go ahead. It's cool. Curse gone.
Wooga wooga. Speaking of corrections, the homework this week was Morgan Freeman reads Everyone Poops.
Yes.
It is adorable and it is funny, but it is not Morgan Freeman.
It's not Morgan Freeman?
Yes. Were you aware of this? I was going to ask. It is not.
It sounds exactly like Morgan Freeman. It's got Morgan Freeman picture on it.
It is white, vaguely middle-aged impressionist Joseph Scales.
Big nice. White.
Looked it up. He's one of those YouTube impressionists, you know, one of those people like, I'm going to do 30 impressions in 60 seconds. Patch Adams doesn't count. Everyone can do Patch Adams, YouTube. Stop doing Patch Adams impressions. Stupid ass movie. But he made a bunch of videos of his impressions because he does do a very good job. A very, very good job. And so Reddit put it on the front page, and then suddenly this guy exploded all over the place. And now he's a professional voice actor.
Nice. Good for him.
Yeah, good for that guy. Good for that guy. He just records a video of him doing a Morgan Freeman impression.
Yeah.
And now he's doing voices for commercials and TV shows and cartoons and video games and stuff like that. Good for that guy. Good for Joseph Scales.
Come really on, come. So come watch Bob. Help me explode.
Right? You heard the man, Reddit.
Yeah, what the hell is it about Reddit? How does one get on Reddit? I have no idea, but my friend made, and I'll probably put it in this episode. My friend made a music video for a book from a local author.
Okay.
So he finished it. He posted it on YouTube. He contacts me. He wants me to give it a look and give him my opinion. And it's horrible.
Yeah.
It's horrible. I wish there was a nice way of me telling you this.
Yeah.
It's really fucking bad. Somehow it got on Reddit. It's over 200,000 hits.
Really?
250,000 hits, sorry. Yeah.
Reddit just seems to be one of those like a clickbait websites, you know?
Yeah.
Where it's just like, here's 35 ways to beat the summer heat and sex somehow. It just just seems like it's all a trick, you know?
Yeah.
It's all bull crap. I don't get it. I don't get it.
Yeah.
My kids have become those, you know, kids that will sit and watch YouTube videos of someone else playing video games.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Like they're watching a TV show.
Except
it's just somebody else playing a video game.
Yeah, I find that a really strange phenomenon. And some of them have some incredible production value.
Yeah.
You know, it's like I don't watch those videos, but like I'll be looking for a tutorial on some of the software I use, like After Effects, Premiere, Cinema 4D or something like this, Photoshop even. And I'll find a tutorial about what I want to find out about, and it's some kid editing his game.
Yeah.
So like I'm watching him do color correction on Halo, you know?
Yeah. I don't get it. I don't get it. But good for this guy, you know, makes a... He does sound very much like Morgan Freeman.
Yes, and I'm sure he poops.
Morgan Freeman?
The both of them.
Yeah.
Not
yeah,
together, you know, I don't mean yeah, together well, or like yeah, in each not, other's mouths or anything like that, but
yeah.
They both poop.
Not, yeah. Not together.
Yeah.
Oh, and I want to mention that this week, this episode, I was going to mention this in the beginning, but I forgot. This episode, we're going to some pretty dark places, people.
Yeah.
So buckle up.
Yeah.
We're going all cereal in this episode. And not cereal, the food that you eat for breakfast or sometimes dinner if you're my family. No. Talking about cereal, the popular crime podcast. We're going all the jinx in this. I wasn't going to tell the story. Because this movie got me thinking about my childhood, and I look back at my childhood, and I realized that I personally knew all of the players in one of the biggest scandals in the history of the Catholic Church.
Okay.
And I'm like, I wasn't sure if I should tell the story, because it requires a lot of explanation, and some of it's pretty messed up. And,
but nobody listens anyway, so.
And also, it's only very loosely related to the actual movie, and it's a long story, but it just has to be done.
Okay.
You know? Has to be done. So I've got a long story, it's funny, and it's dirty, and there's crime, and there's fires, the ATF, the Catholic Church, there's death in this, sex, the Oogie Loves are involved very loosely.
Yes.
Joe Estevez is in this story.
Okay.
That's a sign of quality.
It is.
Joe Estevez is in something. That's when you're like, ooh.
Could you get Udo Kier?
No. Oh. Joe Estevez. Udo Kier will appear anywhere if you give him enough money, I'm assuming.
Oh, yes.
Because he's been in so many movies. that you just have to like wave a few hundred dollars in his face and then he'll wander onto your set. Like trying to get a stray cat, like petting a stray cat. That's how you get Udo Kier to be in your movie.
Yeah. Yeah. $300 he was in my wedding video.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's pretty much the going right there.
Yeah. After breaking up the wedding, he walked up to me and said, "You've not seen the last of me." Then he walked off dramatically, and the theme from Dynasty started coming up and could be heard from anywhere. No, we didn't know where the music was coming from.
Dynasty. Nice. Nice. I've never heard Serial. I've never watched The Jinx. So I wasn't fully able to turn this very lurid crime story into a parody of those things. But this is still a real good, strong story.
Okay.
It's gonna be a long story. It's gonna be a long story. It was difficult to get the specifics of the actual crimes and when it happened and the years that all of these things happened. I read many newspapers, the Washington Post, the New York Times, the Arizona newspaper, whatever that's called, forgot what that's called. The Arizona Republic, that's what it's called. The Phoenix New Times, there's a website that really helped me out, bishopaccountability.org.
Wow, okay.
It's called, did a lot of work. It's strange when you look back at your childhood and you're like, oh, wait a second. I wonder what happened to all of those people that taught me. Oh, wait a second. So that person's in prison. Okay, so that person is on probation. Okay, that person fled the country. Okay, that person came out of retirement to try and put out the fires from all the other people. So this is going to be a good, strong story, and I'm excited to tell it.
Good, good. We should probably cover the movie.
Yes, and, no, we're going to be
tie in the story, yeah.
We're going to talk about the movie. Eileen Brennan is in this thing.
Eileen Brennan, yes.
The thing is that I only know her from one thing.
What else do you know her from?
Clue. She was Clue. Mrs.
Yes.
Yes, and she is wonderful in that. You know Clue, don't you, Bella? I love Clue. Clue is such a wonderful movie.
Yeah, you don't play the game with me.
Oh, no, I hate the game. The game is horrible. I hate the game, Bella. I love the movie.
I've liked the game. I've never seen the movie.
You have seen the movie. You just don't remember. No. You've seen the movie a bunch of times. Yes, Maxwell? Yes, Maxwell, what do you have to say to the podcast?
Ba-bam, ba-bam, ba-ba-ba-bam.
Oh, you have to sing an impromptu ad-lib song about Batman?
Iron Man.
And now Iron Man?
Let's continue actually talking about the movie.
Okay. Wow, Bella, way to boss around my podcast. Jeez.
She was in a few things, and I would probably even miss whatever her big ones were, but she... was in another made-for-TV movie called The Night That Panicked America, which was about Orson Welles' War of the Worlds.
Nice.
But they took it from the perspective of these people are hearing it for real. These are the people who panicked during that.
Okay.
It's really good. You should check it out. But she was in that. And then I'm not sure if she was in one of these movies or both of these movies or which one she was in. It was either Murder by Death or The Cheap Detective.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Which were pretty close to being the same fucking movie.
Yeah.
Murder by Death was a Agatha Christie-style murder mystery comedy where they rounded up all the great detectives and put them in this house to solve this murder.
Yeah.
Peter Falk played kind of a Bogart-type character. And then Eileen Brennan was basically his Lauren Bacall.
Yeah.
And she was pretty hysterical in that.
Yeah, She's been in a bunch of things. I didn't realize that she has been acting steadily over the past. Well, she's dead now, but she was in so many things that I just never watched. She was in Seventh Heaven. She was in Will and Grace. She was in Miss Congeniality 2. Never saw that. She was in Blossom.
Private Benjamin.
Private Benjamin, I think I saw it when it first came out. My mom was one of those moms that would just, if she wants to see a movie, she's taking her kids, whether or not it's appropriate or anything like that. So I'm pretty sure I saw that. I just don't remember.
Yeah.
Jeepers Creepers. She was in Jeepers Creepers.
Yeah.
Never saw that. But yeah,
that's
the only thing. That's the only thing that I know her from is Clue. So it was nice to see. It's like, oh, wow, she can act beyond Clue. That's nice. Nice to see she actually has.
Oh, God, yeah.
Acting ability. And it was nice seeing Ben Gazzara.
Ben Gazzara, yeah.
Dad, George. Because I've seen him in a bunch of things. He was in Summer of Sam and Roadhouse. And, yes, of course, Jackie Treehorn.
Yes.
He was Jackie Treehorn in The Big Lebowski. I kept thinking of Jackie Treehorn when that movie was when I was watching.
That was the one thing that just flat out amazed me about this movie is that this movie just had, it was just chock full of faces.
Yeah. A lot of faces. Charles Fleischer was in this movie.
The voice of Roger Rabbit, for God's sake. Voice of
Roger Rabbit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And he was also in Back to the Future 2. That's the other thing I know Charles Fleischer from is Back to the Future 2.
I get He's a little confused. I get a little confused if he was on Quantum Leap.
A lot of people were on Quantum Leap. Yeah. He probably was at some point. Quantum Leap was like a... back then what Law and Order is now.
Yeah.
You know, everybody was on Law and Order.
So yeah, Charles Fleischer. What?
Besides, there are so many Law and Orders that have been out there.
Yes, they have.
Robbie Benson, though, who played Richie, the sensitive but confused teen.
Yes.
The only I looked at his resume, his impressive IMDb page. There's only one real thing I know him as.
Yeah. City and Limits? That's,
No. The Beast.
Oh, The Beast, yes.
From Beauty and the Beast.
Uh-huh.
And I'm also impressed at the fact that he continued to be the Beast. In Beauty and the Beast 2, and Beauty and the Beast, Belle's Christmas Adventure, and Beauty and the Beast, the video game, and Beauty and the Beast, Beauty's Tropical Island Adventure in Space.
Mm-hmm.
Or every time they used the Beast, it was still Robbie Benson. I liked that.
Yeah.
Robin Williams wasn't always the genie.
No.
But Robbie Benson was always the Beast. I like that. He is even listed as being the Beast in the new Disney Infinity game.
Nice.
I mean, he did Beauty and the Beast, like, what, 1991, 1992? So that's impressive that he's still saying, oh, you want me to go to the studio and record me growling for a while? Okay. I will do that. I found out something weird about Robbie Benson.
Yeah.
That I wanted to talk about.
Okay.
Robbie Benson has two kids.
Yes.
And their names are Lyric and Zephyr.
Uh-huh. And from his website, I learned that Zephyr just shot a movie in Manhattan on DSLR.
Zephyr Benson.
Yeah.
Zephyr Benson. That's really fun to say. Zephyr Benson.
Yeah.
Zephyr Benson.
So Robbie is trying to use his Hollywood pull, you know.
Well, then what's Lyric doing? Benson.
I have not heard of Lyric.
Were there lyrics to the show Benson? I don't think there were lyrics to that.
There were not lyrics.
I think it's just an instrumental theme.
I think so.
I don't think there are lyrics to Benson. Although, in retrospect, I think I may have watched Ice Castles at one point in time.
I'm pretty sure I saw Ice Castles when it was new and would come on like HBO or something like that.
I don't know if I'm from the park.
Yeah. But never has he stretched as much as he did in City Limits, the lost episode of Mystery Science Theater.
Ah, okay. City Limits.
He answered a phone like a motherfucker. He really did. I cried.
He also directed a bunch of episodes of Friends and Ellen. I did not know that.
Yeah.
About Robbie Benson. So anyway, this week's movie is a made-for-TV movie from the 1950s called The Death of Ricky, in which a frustrated and battered housewife, played by Lucille Ball, finally gets her revenge on her conceited, demanding Cuban band leader husband.
Yes.
The most memorable scene is when Lucy has just beaten Ricky to death with his own bongo drums. And the police barge in, and they see Lucy, and she's covered in blood, and the policeman says, "Lucy, you've got some splaining to do." And Lucy just breaks down in tears.
Yeah.
That was my favorite scene.
That was... No, I was definitely there for the end, you know, after her running through the house and Ricky chasing her and punching and beating her, and until she finally finds her inner strength, you know, remembers back to all the Lifetime movies that she's watched.
Lifetime movies, yes.
Gets tough and eventually straps Ricky to the bed, puts the lighter fluid down, puts on dark sunglasses, cigarette dangling out of Ricky the corner of Lucy's mouth. Lights the Zippo, puffs on the cigarette, and says, "Here's your Babaloo," and throws the Zippo as it spins
in slow motion.
Until it lands on Ricky and he bursts into flames. Yeah, that was my favorite scene of that movie.
And then his screams sound a lot like his laughter. So Ricky's running around in flames going, quite moving.
Yeah. And let me just take this one moment to appeal to Hollywood for a moment. Stop it with the fucking Zippo lighters already. It's getting as bad as crawling through an air duct, okay? It's the number of smokers to begin with is dwindling to an incredible low, all right? And then out of those people, most people use the disposable Bics. It's hard-pressed to find somebody who has a Zippo.
Yeah, you can't start a fire by throwing a e-cigarette.
Nobody in movies smokes, but somebody always has a Zippo.
Yeah, somebody always has a Zippo.
Yeah, so... That rant is over with. Richie.
Doesn't Robbie Benson also have a son named Zippo? Zephyr, Lyric, and Zippo.
Yeah, but they had to lose Zippo when they made it to the movies.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it's a good point.
Because Zippo was just the straight Benson.
Yeah, Zippo was the straight Benson.
And he worked really well when it was just a vaudeville act. But when it came to the movies, they can get bigger stars to do the same thing.
I'm going to write that down because that sounds so wonderful. Zippo was the straight Benson. Yeah.
Yes.
Did you write that down, honey?
No.
No, you haven't written that down? Remember that for me, though, okay? Okay, yeah, text it to me. Zippo was the straight Benson.
Have you gotten secretarial help on your side?
Possibly. But that's just a wonderful pull quote. Zippo was the straight Benson.
So if you are not, if the end of the movie has not already been ruined for you by the title of the movie, we have the opening scene in the graveyard.
Yes.
Richie is really, really dead. They're not playing around with the death of Richie. They will make sure everybody viewing this knows at the beginning, Richie is dead.
It's like a Sunset Boulevard, starting with the lead character floating dead in a pool.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Just to let you know, this is where we are leading to. That sort of a thing.
Yes, but see, the difference here is that in Sunset Boulevard, they set up such a story where you really wondered how he got in the pool.
Yeah.
With the death of Richie, we know from the plot synopsis, drugs. That's how he got in the grave.
Yep. Uppers, downers, screamers, laughers, gassers, pink fireballs, red suspenders, purple trousers, green screaming farts. All the drugs from the 70s.
Mm-hmm. So stepping into the movie has to really work hard now to keep our attention and show us something that we weren't expecting.
Yeah. Mommy's outside, baby. The problem that I had with this movie is that I did, as I usually do, I did my research first.
Yes.
I did my research, and then I watched the movie. But in retrospect, I shouldn't have done that, because I like making fun of the movies that we watch.
Yes.
I do. But I came across so much, yay, a vast multitude of reviews that painted this film as being so important.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm slamming my fist right now, but it's on the couch, and it doesn't have the right effect. If I had a desk, I would be slamming my fist down at the desk.
Yes.
Because there's so many just reviews that I saw. All parents should watch this, and this film is important, a critically important film for people who have a loved one struggling with addiction. There's just so many high and mighty platitudes that are shoveled on this old ass made for TV movie. It's like it's unriffable.
Yeah, but unriffable. I was there at the time. Okay,
it's a miracle.
This was the whole start of the whole idea of tough love and all of that. And this is based on a true story. And the guy it was based on was held up as a fucking hero.
Yeah, and ultimately not charged in the death of his son.
No, not charged.
Yeah.
Spoiler alert.
Richie dies.
Richie dies. Ben Gazzara shot him. Which, if you think about it, that's a pretty cool way to go. I would be satisfied if Ben Gazzara shot me, and that's why I died.
Ben, I would be all right if Jackie Treehorn shot me to death.
Yeah.
As long as I got to go inside of his awesome-ass house. It's a beautiful house with naked chicks being thrown into the air.
Yeah. It's better than how, you know, we'll probably go being crushed by a tractor trailer on the highway either to or from work.
Yes.
So Ben Gazzara shooting me? That's an upgrade.
Yes, it is very much an upgrade. So, I liked the movie well enough. The movie was good.
Yes.
It's just I have a problem with the concept of this movie feels to me to be like it's in the wheelhouse, the sort of the Go Ask Alice world of let's scare teens
yes
into behaving.
Oh, most certainly. Oh, yeah.
I have a problem with that.
And the problem that I had throughout most of the movie is like, Richie has a whole other side to this story that they're not bothering to show us. His dad really is kind of a dick.
Yes.
And he proves it several times. No wonder, you know, I'm thinking there's a lot more going on in that home life than is ever shown in that movie, where you can kind of see, oh, okay, well, that's why Richie goes out and gets high every night.
Yeah. With his friends,
Roger Brent Rabbit.
And Peanuts. Yeah.
Roger and Rabbit Clint, and Peanuts. And
Clint Howard.
Who the fuck was that other guy? That other guy, his face is so familiar. And I kept meaning to look him up, but I forgot.
Yeah, no, I do not know.
Like, he looks like he would be the guy who would be standing behind Carmine Ragusa. You know?
Yeah.
He would be one of those.
Yeah. That's a good call.
And basically, Richie is a good kid, but the drugs.
The drugs.
There's no other motivation than the drugs themselves.
Yeah.
It's not that his father is an authoritarian asshole who puts his foot down.
Yes.
And kept avoiding the idea of talking to his son.
Yeah.
In several scenes, that was plain and obvious, but no more so than when he was in front of the fucking judge.
Yeah.
And the idea of counseling. No, Richie's dad, he's not going to do the counseling.
Yeah, I can understand the idea of there's a lot more that they're not showing. Because the dad wasn't charged, but there's definitely a huge part of this that's his fault. That's everybody's fault.
Yeah.
Society.
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 Mm-hmm.
Maybe we should take a break. Should we take a break?
Let's take a break.
Let us take a break. We will be right back with more of this week's film, The Death of Richie, after this.
Faye Ray. Janet Lee. Adrian King. Heather Langenkamp. Amy Steele. That weatherman who saw the cockroach.
Oh my god!
Jamie Lee Curtis. And you. Come on. You know you wanna. Let her rip. There. Now don't you feel better? You are now officially a Scream Queen. Come play with the rest of us at www.screamqueens.com. That's Queens with a Z. Or you could subscribe to us on iTunes. Either way, it's gonna be fucking fabulous. The Scream Queens Horror Podcast. It's where horror gets bent.
Do you like comic books?
Me too!
Do you listen to podcasts?
Are you still talking to me?
Cool! I have one called The Comic Book Update.
So?
I do weekly reviews of story arcs, comic miniseries, ongoing titles, and more!
I don't care.
I know, right? So all you have to do is go to the website at comicbookupdate.com.
Why would I do that?
We post daily previews of new comic books every day.
Ugh, someone save me.
And every weekend is Cosplay Sunday, with blog posts featuring cosplayers from around the world.
Excuse me, miss, is this guy bothering you?
Back off, buddy. She's with me.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Sorry. Nerd rage.
Oh, yeah.
So check out the Comic Book Update at comicbookupdate.com, as well as on iTunes, and stream it live on Stitcher. The Comic Book Update, the antidote for nerd rage.
And we are back.
It's just a total...
Oh, that was just random?
Yeah, that was just random. I have a request.
Okay.
Okay. I was talking to my family, and we were talking about what movie we should do next week.
Yes.
And we were going through the Netflix.
Okay.
As my son likes to call it. And we came upon Troll 2.
Yes.
Troll 2. Okay.
My family is a big, big fan of Troll 2. Have you seen Troll 2?
I have seen Troll 2. I have. Okay. Heard about the whole cult phenomena and watched the documentary on the cult phenomena.
The documentary is very good.
I've had a hard time wrapping around that movie. Let's do it, but yeah, who's requesting it?
Oh, my wife, my family, everybody.
Okay.
Include everybody. Emerald did not.
Yeah, Emerald did not. But yes, I had a few requests.
Okay, we could do it.
Yeah. My wife is very excited right now.
Totally, yeah. I don't hate this movie. It's just that it's not bringing up the cult fever that it brings up in so many other people. You know what I mean?
No, I'm not.
Okay. I love the movie. I absolutely love the movie.
Yeah.
It's just amazing and wonderful and stupid and horrible, and it's just great. I love this movie.
Every movie podcast has to do Troll 2 at one point or another.
Yes.
You know, it's just one of those.
You know, we can always watch Zombiever.
Zombiever.
Yeah, Natasha also wants to watch Zombiever.
Yeah. I'm afraid that is
the description. I just like the title.
I've been hovering around that movie, and I'm just afraid that it's going to be a one joke movie, which I hate that.
I'm hoping that it's right up there with Wolf Cop. So when I heard that Wolf Cop, I said, okay, well that sounds horrible, but
yeah,
you know, it really was a whole bunch of fun. And I'm hoping that Zombiever is right up there. I mean, I don't know. I have not seen the movie myself. I think I feel the same way that you do.
Yeah.
But I have high hopes for it.
I have high hopes for it. I have seen so much indie crap on Roku.
Yeah.
You know, and Netflix, like Easter Bunny Kill Kill.
Nice.
Oh, no, 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 no. No. First off, it's one joke. That's all there is. It's a guy in an Easter Bunny suit that's killing people.
Okay.
That's only funny for so long. You know?
Yeah.
And they literally went to a location, did not have a script at all. And you could tell because you got the actors standing there for like a minute or 2 minutes having no idea what to say to each other anymore.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh. Bad movie. Bad, bad movie.
There were two movies that I was considering. I was considering Troll 2, and I don't remember what the other one was. I'm trying to look it up right now. There were two movies that I said, hey, this would be fun.
In the pool.
Oh, you're going in the pool, Maxwell? Yeah. Oh, good.
It was,
did you tell the podcast?
Podcast.
Maxwell.
I'm going in the pool.
Thank you, Maxwell.
I got one we absolutely have to do, though.
Oh, no, 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 no. I've got it.
What do you
Repo the Genetic Opera.
Oh, I love that movie.
That was the other one that I was thinking. Either Troll 2 or Repo the Genetic Opera.
I love that movie. I would be
because
down with
that. Song, Zydrate Anatomy, has been on my phone for so long that my whole family knows that song. Even Bella can sing along to Zydrate comes in a little glass vial, a little glass vial, a little glass vial. She knows the lyrics to the damn song because it's a catchy-ass song.
Yes, it is.
But that song is also indicative of the huge problem of that film. By the time that song comes around, you know what Zydrate is. You know how it works. You've already heard like two songs about it.
Mm-hmm.
So this song is catchy, and it's just repeating everything you already know. And that's every song in the movie.
Yeah.
Every song is someone repeating something you already know.
Oh, I love this movie. I'm not going to say it's a great movie. Not at all. But I love this movie. I love it very much in the Rocky Horror, Phantom of Paradise kind of way.
Yeah.
But yeah, oh, but also on Netflix. Also on Netflix. Have you seen The Apple?
Oh, God, no, I think I have.
Oh, that is so fucked up.
I think I have. Yes, I have. I think I saw that on Netflix, too.
Yeah, we just watched it the other weekend morning. Where you just need to put something stupid on.
No, what happened was I watched that one night by myself. It was last year, I think, and I was sad and drunk pretty much through all of 2014.
Okay.
And I said, I'm staying up late. I'm going to watch a movie, The Apple. Oh, I'm pretty sure that this is that movie that the Village People made. I'm going to watch this. And then it's like, okay, well, this definitely isn't the movie that was made by the Village People.
But it might as well have been.
It might as well have been, yeah. It could have. Could have been that movie easily.
Mm-hmm.
The freaking Rapture.
Yes.
Ugh, God, the Apple, Jesus. Was that a Canon Pictures movie?
Yes, it is.
Tells me that it was? Uh-huh. Okay. I want to see that documentary. Have you heard about that documentary?
It was up on Netflix for a blip. Not on Netflix. It was up on YouTube for a blip. And
yeah.
I watched part of it before it wound up getting yanked.
I really want to see that movie because, God... Rappin', the makers of Breakin' and Breakin' 2 Electric Boogaloo.
Yes.
And the Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2. God, that movie. Jesus, I'm reading a list of the movies that they did.
The house that Chuck Norris built.
Yeah, pretty much. Pretty much. Delta Force, Invaders from Mars, the remake. Alan Quatermain and the Lost City of Gold. Superman 4. God, that was horrible. Masters of the Universe.
Mm-hmm.
Alien from L.A. God, these movies are all shit. They made American Ninja movies?
They
really?
Were fun shit.
Yeah, yeah, they were. They were like if Troma took themselves seriously.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
If Troma said, oh no, we're a serious company and we're going to make good movies, then that's what Canon Pictures was.
Yeah.
You know what other movie is on Netflix that I really, really like, and I've been thinking about this movie a lot because one of the cast members died recently. The Burbs.
The Burbs. Who died?
Tom Hanks' best friend.
Oh.
The other guy. It was Tom Hanks, the other guy that was kind of goading him on. He was also in Groundhog Day.
Yeah, he had
a Disney movie called Blank Check. I loved that guy. I loved The Burbs when it came out.
He had a bit part in Ghostbusters.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, he was a really popular stand-up guy at the time.
Ray, you're chanting. You're chanting, Ray. Love that movie.
So Richie comes home stoned.
Richie. Yes.
And Ben Cazara comes into his room to have a heartfelt discussion.
Yeah.
At least that's what I think he was doing. Basically, he talked at Richie while Richie pretended to be asleep.
Yeah.
So now this tells me that this is not the first time Richie has heard this shit.
Yeah.
Or he wouldn't be pretending to be asleep. And there were some interesting comments that came out in that story that Ben Gazzara was telling.
Yeah.
And it was, Richie was about to take his college board exams. So basically the SATs.
Yeah.
And he was going on about, you know, he'd be the first one in the family. I never got to go to college. This kind of stuff. I'm betting there was a lot of bitching at Richie throughout his life about his grades and how he's got to go to college and he's got to become a doctor or some shit, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm thinking that's a lot of pressure on Richie right there. And the movie just started.
Yeah.
And of course they get into an argument because, you know, Richie's on drugs.
Yes. If the dad had just gone to fucking counseling, none of this shit would have happened.
Like the judge kept saying.
Mm-hmm.
And what Ben Gazzara kept avoiding.
Yeah.
Through the whole fucking movie, he was the one who kept avoiding it. And every time a conversation would, like, threaten to come up, it was Ben Gazzara that started pushing it into a fight. Because he was an authoritarian dickhead.
Yeah.
You know, and throughout the movie, you know, we get peaks of Richie really is a good kid.
Yeah.
And what I kept seeing is that if Richie gets even the slightest amount of positive reinforcement anywhere, he blooms.
Yeah.
But then he's got to go back to the home life. And start taking drugs again. Anytime throughout the whole movie you see Richie happy, he's outside of that house.
Yes.
So I blame the father. I blame the father a lot. This is anti-drug propaganda, this movie. And still an entertaining watch.
Yeah. No, it's a fun movie and all that. I have been on my phone, yeah. But apparently not doing the podcast, no. I also blame the mom, too, because the mom is just unable to do anything.
Yeah.
About it.
How much Valium did you imagine was in their medicine cabinets?
Oh yeah, a lot of mother's little helpers.
Yes.
Yes, very much so.
Yeah, she played a very weak woman who would just give in to Ben Gazzara over any stupidity he would come up with.
Yeah.
What are you doing over there?
Me?
Yeah.
I'm moving some pictures around and trying to get my internet to work on my phone. I got a new phone. I got this new phone. It's LG G4. A lot of G's. I got a lot of G's.
Yeah.
And it's basically like the size of a small tablet.
Mm-hmm.
It's a huge thing. But for some reason, we're having... Like, my wife and I are trying to figure this out because we can't get on the internet on our phones, but apparently I can get on the internet enough to do this podcast with you. So, something's up, and I'm trying to figure it out. So, yeah, I'm doing a bajillion things. And also, this movie, it was good-ish. I feel like there are movies out there that deal with addiction a lot better than this movie did. I can see how, you know, concerned and panicked parents would force their kids and teens to watch this.
Yeah.
But it's like the movie thinks it's important.
Yeah.
You know? It's like the movie thinks it's better than me.
Yes. I would agree with that as well.
Better than me movie? Well, you think you're better than me film? Son of a bitch.
Well, it's also the movie that is saying, yeah, I'm having some problem with my kid. Fuck it, I'll just give him over to the state.
Yeah.
Yeah?
So, and it's based on the true story of Richie Denner. He was a teen. He was shot by his father. The father was ultimately not charged with the death of his son.
Mm-hmm.
The case was written up in Life magazine in 1972, and then it was turned into a best-selling book in 1973 by author Thomas Thompson. That is not a name. That is a punishment.
Yes.
That you give your children because of bad deeds. I'm going to change my name to Steve Stevenson.
Yes.
In honor of Thomas Thompson, because that's a horrible name.
Mm-hmm.
So the Life magazine article was turned into a book and then was turned into this NBC made-for-TV movie. The acting is very good-ish.
Yes.
Very, very good acting, but it just... Yeah, I had a hard time with this movie. I had a hard time with this movie.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
I had a hard time with this movie. Not exactly sure what the problem was I had. It just seemed like... I think it was the reviews that I read before the movie. All the reviews that said, this is the most important movie of all time, and let me explain to you why. My daughter died because she was on drugs.
Yeah.
So mm-hmm. Now that I've told you about my dead daughter, you can't hate this movie anymore.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's like, oh, good. So then it's like, okay, so it's an important movie. I'll sit down, I'll watch it, and I'm watching the movie, and it's just like, oh, God, this kind of sucks, but I can't hate it. Because every review I saw was just important film.
Yeah. An important film. An important film where nothing really much happened exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. Richie was on drugs. This is a problem. Okay. He's out of control. He's out of hand. But how far into the movie did we have to get before he got into any kind of fucking trouble except with his father?
Yeah.
Eventually, he acted up in school and got in trouble there.
Way eventually.
That is the extent of the actual trouble he got into.
Yeah. Pretty much it.
Everything else was hassles with his father. His father, who was a major dick to him all the fucking time.
Yeah.
You know, again, like I said, if a conversation came up or a conversation started happening, Ben Gazzara is the one who would turn it into an argument.
That's having a problem.
Nope. Yeah.
And then we have the great scene where Richie is partying with the straight kids. Just in his room listening to albums, and Ben Gazzara comes in with the cops to search Richie's room for drugs. And after all of it, Ben Gazzara apologizes to the police officers, turns his back on his son, and walks out of the room.
Yeah.
Not, I'm sorry, Richie. You know, I'm sorry I had to do this, but I'm proud of you. Anything. Fucking anything.
I I wanted to smack everybody in this movie. I wanted to just slap the shit out of them. Not Richie, because Richie just, here,
Richie.
Rehab. Just, here, Richie, it's this thing called rehab. You just go over there and then you'll be fine. Now let me just smack everybody else in this movie. Because they should also hold a large portion of the goddamn blame for the shit that happened to you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Lance Kerwin.
Lance Kerwin, yeah.
Lance Kerwin.
On the upside, though, with a title like Death of Richie, no sequel.
The Death of Richie 2 Electric Boogaloo.
Yeah.
Richie comes back to life and performs a breakdancing show. Look, in order to save the rec center.
Look, drugs have made me immortal.
Yeah. Like Hamlet 2.
Mm-hmm.
How did Richie come back to life? Thanks, Jesus.
I think it might be time for story time.
Story time. Oh, well, before story time, I got a list. I've got a list. And it's a damn good list. Because I mistakenly assumed that this week's movie, The Death of Richie, was going to be one of those after-school specials. Were you of the age to watch after-school specials?
Yeah, I'm probably only a year or two younger than Robbie Benson.
Yeah. Because after-school specials, they were hour-long specials. They ran on ABC from 72 to 97.
Yes.
So they were around for a really long time.
And they used to piss me off because they would interrupt Godzilla movies. They used to come on Channel 7, our New York ABC affiliate. Wasn't really an affiliate. It was just fucking ABC in New York. And they had their 4:30 movie, and that's where they would show all the Godzilla movies, all the great horror movies that I loved. Baffled. And, and they would interrupt it for these stupid after-school movies.
Oh, I remember seeing some of these. But
yeah.
The after-school specials, late afternoon, weekdays, after school, oftentimes tackled difficult topics to teach kids lessons and or just scare the shit out of them.
Right.
I remember seeing The Day My Kid Went Punk in 1987.
Yeah.
I vividly remember that one. Because that's awesome.
Yes.
Stories about AIDS and young kids getting pregnant.
Date rape, drinking.
She drinks a little. Yeah. That was another one that they did. I remember The Wave.
The Wave. The Wave was awesome. And they remade that. They remade that from a German film made it.
Yeah. Please Don't Hit Me, Mom.
Yes.
I got a list here of some of them. The Hero Who Couldn't Read. Are You My Mother? Supermom's Daughter. A Question About Sex. My Dad Can't Be Crazy, Can He? That's a good one. I Hate the Way I Look. Bonnie Raitt Has Something to Talk About, played in March of 1995. I think she talked about how horrible her hair looked back in the day. I think that was what her whole episode was. It featured a lot of people that they specifically cast solely to play to young people. Like, I got a list here of some people who are on ABC After School Specials. Eve Plum.
Yes.
Christy McNichol.
Mm-hmm.
In a couple of them. Scott Baio, Kirk Cameron,
ooh,
Nancy McKeon, Joe from what was it? The Facts of Life. Life.
Yeah.
Edie McClurg. I love Edie McClurg.
Which one was she from?
She was the secretary in Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
Oh, yeah, I love her.
And Ferris Bueller's mm-hmm. Day Off is a wonderful movie, but how much did Edie McClurg steal the film that when you quote Ferris Bueller's Day Off, you're probably going to take one of her lines?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
That movie is amazing, but if you're going to quote it, you're probably going to quote the secretary who was hardly in it because she was amazing.
Yeah, just one of those people. Yeah, she completely steals it whenever she's on camera.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And another person who was in a couple of ABC After School specials in the 70s, Ruth Buzzy.
Ruth Buzzy, okay.
I am no Ruth Buzzy standing here. God, I love Wet Hot American Summer. God, I love that movie. And Scott Baio was in a number of ABC After School specials. But in my mind and in my heart, Scott Baio is in charge.
Yes.
Of our days and our nights.
Yes, he is. So no appearances by Leif Garrett?
Oh, yeah. No, Leif Garrett's on there. Leif Garrett's on there.
Knew he would have to be in one of them.
Yeah. Today's movie isn't an after-school special, but that got me thinking about after-school specials. Because after-school specials aren't around anymore. They haven't been around since 1997. And I want to bring them back.
Yeah.
So, I and not just bring them back, but bring them back updated for our cynical modern-day children and their problems, which they think are problems, but actually aren't problems. So I've come up with a list of five modern-day after-school specials
that I think... Let's hear it, yeah.
You know, and I'll give it freely to ABC, because they're obviously listening. So I really do think that this wonderful, wonderful idea of mine will just reboot the entire after-school special series. So I've got five... after school specials. This is my list. Five after school specials. They are gonna explode. Okay?
Okay.
Okay. So this is the first one. It's called The Girl Who Selfied Too Much.
Yes.
And it's about a girl, and she selfies all the time, so she's too busy selfieing, doesn't realize she's walked into the street, gets hit by a car.
Good. Okay, yeah. Uh-huh.
You know who I'm thinking is would be perfect to star in it?
Oh, ooh.
Oh, no, I've got somebody lined up already.
Miley Cyrus?
No, TV's Jessie. It's a show on the Disney Channel called Jessie.
Yeah. About a
girl. I think her name is Debbie Ryan. I think she'd be perfect in this. Anyway. Here's the second movie.
Well, that movie also has to have the duck lips subplot, doesn't it?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
And there has to be, like, speaking of duck lips, there has to be, like a best friend who's in love with the girl.
Yeah.
But the girl is too busy taking pictures of herself to realize that she has love right in front of her.
Yeah. Ducky.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Ducky.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I was thinking. Here's my second movie, modern day after school specials. I really like this one because this really goes with my idea about modern day after school specials for kids and their problems, which aren't really problems, but they think that they're problems. The film is called Help! I've been tagged in an embarrassing photo. Now, this one would have to star a girl, because a boy doesn't give a crap about any of those things.
Yeah.
But for a girl, this is the most important problem facing society. You know who I'm thinking should star in this one?
Who?
TV's Jessie.
TV's Jessie.
It's a show, I think it's on the Disney Channel. called Jesse. I believe the actress's name is, what's her name? Debbie Ryan. That's her name. Okay. So I have another one. This is for our cynical modern day kids. My third movie. It's called The Script That Was Too Meta.
Okay.
And it will be a found footage movie about a group of young teens making a found footage movie about making a found footage movie.
Uh-huh.
And it'll talk not only about making a script too meta, but about how there are too many found footage movies out there.
Do they actually have a script? And do they read forward in the script?
I think it will be like kind of off and on, like backwards and forwards.
Yeah.
And then eventually you get to the middle, which will be the end.
So we could have a scene like, this happened. Just like in the script.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there's going to be a group of teens in this one, but I'm thinking that the star should be a girl. And you know who I'm thinking of getting the star in this?
Miley Cyrus?
No.
No.
TV's Jesse.
Who's that?
That's a show. I think it's on, what station is that? The Disney Channel. That's it. It's a show called Jesse, and I believe the girl's name is Debbie Ryan. Debbie Ryan.
The one now, from Deep Space one, Nine, right? No, not Deep Space Nine.
No,
Voyager.
It's spelled different. It's spelled different. It's D-E-B-I Ryan. So as to make sure that she doesn't get, people don't confuse her with the chick from Deep Space Nine. She is D-E-B-B-Y Ryan.
Best
this girl is D-E-B-I Ryan.
Best part of Voyager, big tits, nice ass.
Yeah.
Skin tight outfit.
So the fourth movie, this one, I'm trying to convince my kids to, this film is such a great movie. Okay. That I'm trying to convince my daughters to. I want to make this movie.
Kickstarter.
I'm thinking this after school special is such a good idea that it really needs to be made. And I want my daughter to star in it, but I might have to get Amber to star in it and my daughter to co-star in it. Anyway, this might be happening. But the name is, and it's a long title, but the name of the movie is Kirk Cameron Presents The Story of Julie. She tried one marijuana's, and now she's an unwed, pregnant, homeless drug addict with Ebola.
Until she met Jesus?
Well, yeah, she'll be saved by the power of Christ at the end of the movie.
Okay.
But we've updated the whole death of Richie, go ask Alice, let's scare teens sort of thing.
Yes.
Because she doesn't have AIDS, she has Ebola.
Uh-huh.
That's going to be the modern hook.
Yeah.
And just like Go Ask Alice, this will be based on a totally fake true story with finger quotes. You know who I'm thinking to star in this movie?
Miley Cyrus.
No.
No.
The fat Mexican chick from the show Austin and Ally.
Okay.
I believe that's on Nickelodeon. She's a fat Mexican chick, and her gimmick is she has a lot of jobs. Like, she's fired from a different job in every episode.
Uh-huh.
If she's not,
is that because she's Mexican?
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. It's vaguely racist. But yeah. If she's not available, who I'm thinking is TV's Jesse.
And who's that?
It's a show on the Disney Channel. The show is called Jesse. It's about this girl. I believe the actress's name is Debbie Ryan. My fifth movie, I decided to have this last movie cover a lot of ground.
Okay.
So this one is called My Gay Crippled Native American Albino Ginger Dad.
Okay.
It covers a lot of subjects.
I think I read a script like that already.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And TV's Jesse.
Who's that?
It's a show on the Disney Channel. The show is called Jessie. I believe the girl is called, her name, the actress is Debbie Ryan. I read this list to my daughters. My oldest, who is 13, she rolled her eyes at the idea of me reading this list to her. But it really did make her laugh, and she liked the list. I had to fight Bella, though, because she wanted to rip the list up.
Okay, why?
Debbie Ryan drove her fucking nuts.
Yeah.
Drove her insane. She was yelling at me and running around the house screaming like, "Stop saying Debbie Ryan! Stop saying Jesse! If you say Jesse one more time, Dad, It was wonderful. It was a wonderful moment in history.
A bonding moment?
It was a bonding moment. But I really want to film Kirk Cameron Presents the story of Julie. She tried one marijuana's and now she's an unwed, pregnant, homeless drug addict with Ebola. I've got the whole thing pictured in my head. And I want my daughter to star in it because she's blonde-haired, blue-eyed. I mean, she has to be the star.
Yes.
I especially want to film to have her as the star because after she tries the one marijuana's at a party, she blacks out immediately and wakes up in an alley pregnant. And I want her to say the line that she said back in the day when we made the film version of my wife's life story. I want her to say, "Oh no, I'm knocked up." It'll be like a callback to one of her earlier roles.
Yes.
But she won't do it. She wants to be the cool peer pressure kid that gets Julie to try the marijuanas.
Uh-huh. She wants to be the dealer.
Yeah. I'm going to be playing the part of the older kid with the leather jacket who's throwing the party.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because his parents are in Fiji.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
It's going to be wonderful. So that might be coming soon in a couple of weeks. So keep an eye out for that.
Okay.
Anyway, do you want to take a break before we get into the gist of my crazy story?
Let's take a break. Jeannie all just right. came home. Give me a chance to say hello.
Cool. I'm going to check on my kids, make sure they're not dead.
Okay. Do you want to sign us out?
Yes. We will be right back with more of Not Today, this week's movie, right after this, in 2 and 2.
What's that sound? Coming to you through the electric mist, it's the Midnight Cinephile, with new episodes every Wednesday night.
We had a small mishap.
Here are the keys. Here are ours.
Have a nice stay at Milbon.
You in our city.
Still telling the same story, Josh?
Powers of evil are very strong here. I must leave.
Goblins don't exist.
And remember,
they're going to eat me.
dizzy.
Kids with a sweet tooth like yours love ice cream.
Delicious and purified.
Wait, would you like to talk back to the Pope on Film? Like our Facebook page by searching Pope on Film. You can follow us on Twitter at Pope on Film. Or hey, even email us at Pope at Undead County. Not sure how to listen? Well, you can find us in the iTunes store by searching Undead Cows. It's fine, it's all one word, Undead Cows. And you can check us out on YouTube, even. It's youtube.com/listener/... Check us out on YouTube at youtube.com/users/UndeadCowFilms. Or, you know, if you need, find us at Stitcher? You know? Yeah, Stitcher. Because not all of us have a great... Or you can find us at Stitcher. It's the RC Cola of podcast servers. Or if you must, you can close your two-color version of Tetris on your flip phone and find us at Stitcher.
And we are back.
Now, what... So, we're going to get into my story now. It's... a story I haven't really told. It's a weird story, but what the impetus for telling this story is, this isn't an after school special, but I thought it was. And you mentioned that this was a film that they would show you in like health class.
Oh yeah. Uh-huh. To scare you out of taking drugs.
Does health class exist anymore? Yeah.
I have no idea.
It does, Emerald? Like what age, what grade do you get health class? Starts in sixth? Yeah. Did you, and does it continue through like seventh and eighth grade? Yeah? Is that where you learned about your body and how you're blossoming into womanhood? You did learn CPR. Oh, well, no, you're supposed to learn, like, cooking and how you're going to bleed.
That's home ec.
Misogynist? No, I don't give massages, Emerald. I'm not a massagist.
Suck it.
Emerald! But you're becoming a... She slammed the door. Okay. That was still good. That was golden. I wasn't sure if it existed anymore. I thought maybe... Republican and or Democrats had killed home ec class.
Yeah.
I mean a health class. I mean, it could be Republicans saying, oh, we can't talk about bodies. That's... But it could also be the Democrats also equally going, people are fat. We need to all exercise constantly and healthy food.
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't have a health class, you know? I never had... health class per se. What I had was infinity times worse. I was taught health and our body and sex and birds and bees and whatnot from a priest.
Okay.
Worst case scenario.
Oh, yeah.
Is that right there? We would have a priest come and talk to us. I went to a Catholic school from first grade to eighth grade, not because my parents were super religious. They just didn't want the skinny crybaby Mexican kid to be beaten up in a private school, in a public school. So I went to a private Catholic school. And so I in the process of my research for the death of Ricky, I ended up doing a bit of investigating to see what happened to the priests that were in charge of teaching me. And and to be fair, I didn't learn anything I didn't already learn from my father's hidden penthouses in the bathroom. But simple. So what I accidentally uncovered when I was doing the investigating to see what happened to the priests in charge of teaching me, what I uncovered was a crazy, sad, dirty, suspicious tale of crime and conspiracies, the likes of which you would expect to see on The Jinx or Serial or one of those other things that apparently the majority of white America likes.
And it would star Miley Cyrus?
No, I was thinking TV's Jesse is what I was thinking.
Who's that?
It's a show called Jesse on the Disney Channel. Suddenly kids TV is filled with really bad live action sitcoms. Like every other show on the Disney Channel and Nickelodeon is Saved by the Bell, but worse.
Oh, God.
It's really sad. Dog with a Blog. There's a show called Dog with a Blog. That should not exist.
No.
When I was in high school and there was Animaniacs, and that was a wonderful show. It didn't talk down to kids. Now we have Dog with a Blog.
Yes, but Animaniacs was a brief shining moment.
Yes, it was.
Because before then it was He-Man.
Yeah. So anyway, I was weary about going into this story, not because of any... I am not a part of this story. I just happened to look back at my life and realize, oh, wait a second. I knew all of the players in one of the biggest sex abuse scandals in the history of the Catholic Church. And this is an interesting story. But I wasn't sure if I was going to say it like I asked you previously, for kind of like a vague green light. Because it's only loosely related to the podcast. Like, I wanted to justify it somehow. I mean, technically, this movie is about a crime.
We could do anything we want. We're not getting paid.
I know. I know. Okay, so...
Okay, but before you go there, since you have firmly established at the beginning of the story that you are not involved in the story...
Yes.
Did you kind of feel like, oh, well... What was wrong with me, Father? Not cute enough for you? Not sexy enough?
I think it was because I wasn't a good enough Catholic.
Yeah.
Because I think that like there was a period in time where it could have happened, but I think it was just because the priest in question knew that I was pretty much going to be this, you know?
Yeah.
I wasn't going to grow up to be like to join the seminary or anything like that. Like he knew that I was a different one.
Yeah. Maybe. Anyway. Maybe he kind of thought like, oh, that one would tell. That one would definitely tell.
Yeah. Yeah. He thought I was stronger. Maybe. Anyway, I went to a very small-ish private Catholic school in Phoenix, Arizona, from first grade to eighth grade. I graduated eighth grade in 1991, so you do the math because I don't like math. Okay. I'm not going to mention the name of the school, not because of any legal reasons, but just out of respect. I liked the school. Okay. I liked going to private school, to Catholic school, for one reason. It kept me young.
Okay.
I know a lot of people and who say things like, oh man, I had sex for the first time when I was 11, and oh, I was drinking when I was 13. Oh, when I smoked pot for the first time when I was 12, and it's like, oh, you know what I was doing when I was 12? I was memorizing Monty Python and the Holy Grail.
Yeah.
You know what I was doing when I was 11? I was getting my hands on every Godzilla movie I could find. I'm not one of those people, and the reason why I was not one of those people is solely because I went to a private school, and so I respect the school. I liked it there. It did a good job of keeping me my age. But it's not impossible for anyone listening to this to do some very quick fact checking to Bing it and to figure out the name of the school. Still, I'm going to just call it Saint Frustration and Guilt Catholic School in Phoenix, Arizona. I went to Saint Guilt and Frustration Catholic School in Phoenix, Arizona.
No Bloody Heart in that?
No, that was taken. That was taken by a number of other schools. Thank you, honey. For those of you who might not know, there's this real bizarre hierarchy in the Catholic Church that I never understood, of like priests, and then there's like higher up priests, and then there's priests higher than that. There's levels of bosses. It's the same way with angels, and I never understood that. Like, there's angels, and then there's archangels.
Yeah.
And then there's seraphim, and then there's like the community relations angel.
Yes.
The project manager angel, the vice angel. Like, I'm to believe that if I ever go to heaven, it's just going to essentially be office space. And there's going to be angels there going, so, Gabriel, what's happening? I see you've been having some trouble with your TPS reports. If you could fly in and work on Saturday, that'd be great. So there's priests, and then there's like monsignors. I'm not sure what the going rate is for a monsignor nowadays. Is maybe like 10 priests to one monsignor. I don't know. I should Google. I should Bing that. I should Alta Vista it.
Well, maybe they're like priests from another parish. Like a visiting priest or something like that. Star Trek, okay? If another captain came on board the Enterprise, he was no longer captain. He was Commodore. Because there can only be one captain on a ship. So maybe it's the same thing.
Maybe, because mainly there were nuns that ran the school. They were all old. They were all perpetually 70 years old.
Yes.
And I think some of them might be evil. The school was ran by a woman named Sister Raphael. And when I was in first grade, she was 80 years old. I'm assuming she was 80 years old. When I graduated eighth grade in 1991, she was still 80 years old. I follow the school on Facebook. She's still running the school, and she is still 80 years old. And now it is 2015. She hasn't aged a day. It's like Ash Ketchum from Pokemon.
Yeah.
Ash is constantly a 10-year-old boy, and Sister Raphael is constantly 80 years old. That Pokemon reference was from my daughter Emerald. I would now like to give a shout out to my daughter Emerald.
Go for it.
Emerald! That was a shout out. No, that was just a shout out. It's good. Literally shouting out. It's a new thing. Amber came up with it. So, mainly nuns ran the school. There was a random scattering of very old priests. And then we had one Monsignor. His name was Monsignor Moyer. And he's the one who taught me about sex. He would, seventh grade, they would separate the boys and the girls.
Uh-huh.
And the girls went with a nun, which I imagine would be even worse. And we went with Monsignor Moyer. And he didn't really talk about sex.
Well,
but
what did he know?
Well, basically what he did was, okay, kids, you know, we're just going to have like a conversation. We're going to have a little rap session, you know, you and me. And we can talk about whatever you want, whatever you want. Ask me anything. And I'll answer it. It's okay. We can talk about sex. We can talk about alcohol or drugs. You know, just ask me anything. Feel free. Ask me anything. We're just going to talk. Just hang out. Just rap together.
See, now, putting everything else aside, okay, what is the wisdom of having the guy who doesn't have sex teach the kids about sex?
I don't know, but in all honesty, we asked a little bit about sex, but mainly we asked him if all the urban legends we heard were true. Okay. I remember that, and I remember being like kind of excited about that. We can ask you about anything. Okay, does Bigfoot exist? What about the Loch Ness Monster? What about, we heard this one thing where this guy decided to walk through town, and if nobody smiled at him, then he was going to kill himself, and nobody smiled at him, so he killed himself and he died. Is that true? And then, of course, there was the one kid who kept asking about masturbation. Yeah, I've got a question about masturbation.
Well, but that would be a topic that a priest would know something about.
Exactly.
Okay.
I mean, we asked him some questions about sex, but it was obvious that we were supposed to ask him questions about sex.
Yeah.
It's like, wait a second, we see what's going on here. Later on, we learned that the girls got to see a movie. The girls got to see an uncomfortable movie that freaked them out and showed them graphic scenes of pregnancy. We had just a fat, perpetually 80-year-old balding Monsignor, whatever that is, saying, oh yeah, just ask me anything. You're gonna, whatever you want, just ask him anything. And of course, there's the one kid with his hand constantly, yeah, I have another question about masturbation. Yeah, I have a third, fourth, and fifth question about masturbation. The funny thing is that I'm not joking, and I remember that kid, and I'm Facebook friends with that kid, and I'm not going to mention his name, although I really want to, because it's funny, but I'm not going to. I asked him one question.
Yeah.
I asked Monsignor Moyer one question, which is a question that really does just bug the shit out of me to this day, and he did not give me an effective answer.
Okay.
Because I went to the bathroom at a really dirty gas station, and there was a chick tract in there.
Okay, yeah.
Little chick tracts.
Jack chick.
Yeah,
yeah.
Those little inflammatory comic books that would scare you into loving Jesus.
Oh, they're beautiful.
I found one at work a week ago.
Yeah.
And was so excited because I didn't think that people cared about them or that they were around. I remember them in the
80s. He's still out there and he's still writing them.
Yeah, he's perpetually 80. Like,
oh yeah.
Like a mother, like a sister Raphael.
Yeah.
I found one and I was so excited, and the manager at my work said, do you know what this is? And I said, yeah, I do. That's a Jack chick track. You've never seen a chick track before? Which one is this? Is it the Titanic one? I love that one. She has no idea what the hell I'm talking about. And I'm trying to explain to her how it's a thing.
Yeah.
And that people know it. Like someone's never heard of McDonald's before. And I go, no, it's a thing. And they have arches and really bad food, but everybody eats there.
Yeah.
Someone just look at me all confused.
My favorite was the one that told us how the record industry would bring in witches to cast spells over like Led Zeppelin albums and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And how evil Halloween is.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah.
So I found a Jack chick tract. I was in Catholic school, but my parents weren't really Catholic, but they're Mexican, so they have to be Catholic. So
yes.
If you ask them to this day, they'll tell you they're Catholic, but they're not really Catholic. So I found a Jack chick tract in the bathroom, and it said, are Catholics Christian? And I was like in sixth grade, and I said, well, yes, of course Catholics are Christians. Let me read this. And the whole comic book was about how Catholics are going to hell.
Yes.
And it freaked the shit out of me. I didn't know that people hated Catholics and hated the Pope and all of this stuff. So I asked Monsignor Moyer, are Catholics Christian? And he didn't say anything for a really long time, and I followed that up with, because I read this comic book, and it said that Catholics aren't Christian, and that Catholics are going to hell, and I've been taught that Catholics are Christian. A lot of people, when you guys are talking to us, you say that we're Christians, but apparently Christians don't think we're Christian. So what does that mean? And his answer was this. He said, and I quote, "Well, all Catholics are Christians, but not all Christians are Catholics." Okay, does anyone else have a question?
Nice, okay.
And I'm still, to this day, really pissed off about that.
Yeah, that's a non-answer. Uh-huh.
And it's like, does anyone else have any questions? Yes, I have a seventh question about masturbation. So anyway.
Because there's this girl on the Disney Channel.
No, back then it would have the 90s, so maybe a Minnie Mouse.
Oh no, if we're going to the 90s, is still the boss on, is Who's the Boss still on? It would have to be
Alyssa Milano.
Yeah.
The weird thing is that I forgot her name when you said Who's the Boss. So the way I remembered her name is by remembering the name of Star-Lord's ship in Guardians of the Galaxy. Oh, what's the name of that chick? Oh, his ship is the Milano, Alyssa Milano. That's nice. How my mind works. Just wanted to give you a look at the map inside my head. So the school had a church, okay? And it wasn't a church. It was a cathedral. The thing is freaking huge and beautiful, like gaudy. It was created in like the 1930s or 40s. It's, even atheists would be like, dude, okay, this is pretty nice. It really big, huge, huge-ass cathedral. Lots of priests, one Monsignor. Mostly the priests were fuddy-duddies, I guess, is what you would call them. Old fuddy-duddies.
Okay.
There was one priest that stood out. His name was Father Saul.
Uh-huh.
S-A-U-L. Father Saul. He was different. He was very different. All of the other priests, they were like ages 50 to 80. They were very old. Father Saul really stood out because he was from Mexico. He seemed extremely young. He went by his first name because his name, the man's name is Saul Madrid.
Okay.
His first name. So already... There's a
that is father. One smooth priest.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
He's from Mexico. He spoke English very well, but with a big, thick accent. Think like Antonio Banderas around Desperado.
Oh, I totally am, because I'm already hearing in my head. And at night, he fought crime.
And here's the thing. Now, when I'm saying this, I have this like smile in my face because I'm not sure how to say this without sounding horrible. But I'm not going to say that Father Saul was handsome.
Okay.
But if he wasn't a priest, bullfighter.
Bullfighter, okay.
Or mariachi. Or stripper. Okay, he was handsome.
Okay.
He was a handsome guy. If you
It's okay to admit it. It's okay to admit it.
If you Google Father Saul Madrid, the first Google image picture is a really fuzzy, grainy old picture, but it at least gives you an idea of what we're talking about. Because the guy was just a very strange, handsome, and he stood out like a sore thumb, because here are all these like 50-year-old white men, and here's this like, I don't know, 28, 29, 30-year-old young guy from Mexico.
Yeah.
So he was the cool priest. He was the really cool priest. And the reason why I say that was, since we went to Catholic school, we were all forced to go to confession.
Okay.
Like once a month, we had to go and confess things. And every kid wanted to get, because we were a big school, so they would have all of the priests just set up in various parts of the big, huge cathedral.
Assembly and, line confession.
Yeah, it would basically be like, next! And you hoped, you always wanted to get Father Saul, because he seemed like the cool young priest.
I have another one.
Like the cool... I just dropped my computer.
The Department of Motor Vehicle of Sin.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And everybody, there was kind of like an... And here's why forcing confessional is really bad. We had an unofficial sort of list of what you would just say when you went to confessional.
Yeah. Impure thoughts.
I would
anger
always,
toward parents.
Yeah, I would always say that I was really mean to my little sister.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I have no little sister. But I would always say that. And that is just the problem with forcing kids to go to confession. There was one time when I said, okay, I'm going to take this serious. I'm just going to be really honest with this priest. And then, oh, I got Father Saul. Awesome. And I was in eighth grade. I was about to be leaving. So I just said, yeah, I've been having a real big problem with masturbation. I just do it all the time. I love it. And I know it's bad, but it's just so awesome. What should I do? And Father Saul was just like, his jaw was dropped like a Tex Avery cartoon character. Like his jaw was on the floor, and he really did seem like panicked after that and tried as hard as he could to finish and get me out of there. Like, saying that you love masturbation was apparently the one way to like get under Father Saul's skin.
Yes.
Father Smolder. Because he had the smolder in the eyes. He had the smolder.
Uh-huh.
He was a handsome man. Father Smolder. And the one time that I was honest and started telling him about how much I loved masturbation, he freaked out, and it was the quickest freaking confessional I ever had, and I thought that was odd, and then just filed that in the back of my head.
Yeah.
And then that was the end of that. Okay?
Okay.
So that was the end of that. Father Saul, he was the cool priest. He could play guitar, and everybody loved him, and he had an accent, and he had the smolder eyes. Everybody loved Father Saul. So the cathedral that was in the school was kind of the home base for the whole Diocese of Phoenix. So that means we would also get occasional cameos by the bishop.
Nice.
That's a Monty Python reference.
We was too late.
We was too late. The guy's name was Bishop Thomas O'Brien, and in my 14 years in and out of the Catholic Church in Phoenix, I ran across him numerous times. Our paths crossed repeatedly, all the time. He traveled all over Phoenix, but my school was his home base.
Right.
So we would have a lot of visits from him. It was like if whatever elementary school you went to was also, for some inexplicable reason, the occasional home base of...
The Justice League.
I was thinking a senator.
Ah, okay.
So, I mean, he was also appointed personally by Pope JP the
II. Uh-huh.
You know, the last cool pope before this one?
Yeah, the one who really wrote all the songs instead of John Lennon. Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Pope JP the II was the last awesome pope. I saw him in concert. He played the Bourbon Room.
Oh, yeah?
Gang Von Colt opened up for him. It was really awesome.
Cool.
He played all the oldies. It was really great.
Yeah, Taking Care of Business. Because that was like his big hit.
Yeah.
Taking Care of Business every day.
So, yeah. Mm-hmm. So he was appointed by Pope JP the II, Bishop Thomas O'Brien. You know that he did something bad, because out of all of the people who taught me in school, he's the only one with a lengthy Wikipedia page.
Ah, okay.
That's how you know that this guy is going to be like the heavy in the story. He was the boss. He was like the head honcho, the head cheese. He was really good with people and really friendly. He put on a really good face. He did a lot of events and stuff, fundraising. He was really good at that. He was also primarily responsible for getting his homeboy, JP the II, to visit Phoenix.
Nice. Okay.
So the Pope visited Phoenix. It was a big, huge deal. It was live on all the TVs, and I remember exactly what I did.
Bunch of teenage girls throwing their bras at him and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, throwing their hotel room keys.
Yes.
When he came to Phoenix, I remember exactly what I was doing. I was at home watching scrambled porn on cable.
All right. Were you masturbating?
Probably. I was young, so that probably is the answer to that question at any point in my life.
Yeah.
It's just I miss scrambled porn.
Because that used to be a challenge, because you would have to masturbate and try to work the rabbit ear at the same time to try to get that sweet spot that didn't last more than 3 or 4 seconds.
I'm not sure if you guys have this, but in Phoenix and here in Oklahoma, we have Cox Cable.
Yeah.
Do you guys have Cox Cable over there?
I've heard of Cox Cable, though.
Yeah, because everybody talks here about how they have Cox at their home and how they love Cox. And I'm supposed to not laugh.
Yes.
Because society, and it's wrong.
Uh-huh.
But the bishop also got Mother Teresa to visit our school. She came to our school. She came to our cathedral. Now, here's why this is historically important. I spent a lot of time growing up at that cathedral.
Uh-huh.
And as a teen, I got a handy in the men's bathroom by a very slutty woman I knew.
Good.
So this means that I got a handy in a building that was also visited by Mother Teresa. Now, for a while, I thought that this might be historic, you know, one of a kind sort of a thing.
Yeah.
But we are talking about the Catholic Church.
Yes. Now, me personally, and not because I think she's anything to look at or anything like that, but I would do Mother Teresa.
Oh, yeah, if anything, for like the fame factor.
Yeah, I mean, you know, how many people could say that they fucked Mother Teresa?
But because we're talking about the Catholic Church and priests, I'm guessing a lot of people have gotten hand jobs in places where Mother Teresa has visited. But here's why my story is historical.
In fact, that's one of her miracles, isn't it?
Possibly. But my story stands out because I got mine from a woman.
Okay. Yes.
So that's important. I'm dropping the mic right there because that's awesome. And then I'm picking the mic back up because mics are expensive. But back to Bishop O'Brien. He was a very strict guy. He got me in trouble a number of times. I got some detentions for talking and for laughing. I got detention once because my shirt was untucked.
Okay.
I don't think that's fair.
You hooligan.
Yeah, right?
Uh-huh.
We're the hooligans. When I was in high school, I went on a long bus ride road trip with a group of people, including Bishop Thomas O'Brien. And we all decided to watch Jesus Christ Superstar.
Okay.
Okay? I have a huge soft spot for this movie.
Yeah.
I love this movie. Just the concept of it. Let's get the story of Jesus, but let's make it extremely 70s. You know what the last days of Jesus Christ needs? You know what Christ's death needs? Disco.
Yes, it does.
I love Jesus Christ Superstar. And after we watched it, Bishop Thomas O'Brien said that the movie was evil because it made Judas a hero and Judas killed Jesus. And you don't talk about my favorite movies like that. From that point on, I knew that Bishop Thomas O'Brien was an evil man and who would one day kill a person.
See, now, that is where I picture you getting up out of your seat on the bus and slowly approaching the bishop in the background,
I got really pissed recently because my friend Heather Molina posted on her Facebook page that she had been watching Wet Hot American Summer for over an hour and that she hadn't laughed yet.
Oh,
God, I almost unfriended her solely because of that.
And just to interject really quick, we got to mention Panda Candy later.
Yes, absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. I love shouting. I love giving shouts out to her because she's freaking adorable. But from then on, I knew that the guy was evil. I personally felt that I knew that he was sort of an asshole.
Okay.
I knew the future. I knew what was going to happen. I knew the whole story right there because he dissed Jesus Christ Superstar. Uh-huh. I love that fucking movie. You don't make fun of Jesus Christ Superstar. My dad also worked. He worked project estimator for a construction company. So it would be his job to estimate how much their company could build this cheaper than other companies. And if his bid was accepted, then he would be like the project manager for that. So he moved around a lot with various companies doing various jobs. And there was one time when he had to build a church, but Bishop Thomas O'Brien was very hard to my dad and prone to fits of anger and very much a bully. Like he would say, it's like, oh, I know that you guys said that you would build it in like 3 months, but we need it in a month and a half. It has to be done before Easter.
Oh, nice. Okay.
Well, we can't do that. And he's like, well, you have to because the Lord wants it that way.
All right.
And my dad told me that, and it's like, well, yeah, of course he's going to be like that. He hates Jesus Christ Superstar. So
it all comes full circle.
Yeah. So at some point in time, I turned my back on Catholicism. I created my own religion, and I never really looked back. But last week, I was researching for the podcast. I did look back, and I was fairly surprised by what I saw. There was a lot of shit that happened. I put it in a timeline. I knew some of it, but I was surprised at the extent of it. So this is what happened. In the early 90s, Father Saul, Father Smolder,
right,
was quickly moved out of my school and put in charge of a church downtown. In 1994, that church mysteriously burnt to the ground.
Okay.
Which is interesting because a lot of people were accusing Father Saul of not being honest about the funds of the church. But the church mysteriously burnt to the ground, and they found no signs of arson.
Uh-huh.
I should also state at this point in time that numerous articles and websites and articles that I saw noted that Father Saul was a personal favorite of Bishop Thomas O'Brien.
Mm-hmm.
And that might be why Father Smolder was, shortly after the fire, put in charge of a second church in downtown Phoenix. It's not like that church burnt to the ground.
We can't really place any blame here now, can we? I mean, that's just what happens when you build a church over a hellmouth.
But here's the thing. I'm not saying they gave him a second church. He was now put in charge of two churches at once.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And that
promotion
like ever happens. Not like a promotion. Not like a, you burnt that church to the ground. That church burnt to the ground under your watch. Okay, well, here's another one. Because that's the right reaction to that. So eventually, rumors and accusations began popping up with this second church, financial improprieties, and questions regarding Father Saul's sexuality. Apparently, he had like a... One of the newspapers I read, it referred to him as a partner, a guy that wasn't an official part of the church, had no position at all,
uh-huh,
but was constantly next to Father Saul. Had a Yoko.
Okay.
Father Saul had a hetero life mate. Father Saul had a silent Bob.
Yes.
That just followed him around. And this story is so wonderful. Father Saul also appeared in a 1999 R-rated art film called 14 Ways to Wear Lipstick.
Ah.
The movie featured Joe Estevez.
Have you Googled it? Is it out there?
Yes. I haven't found it, but apparently it's a very sexually explicit film. There's a lot of sex. There's a lot of oral sex. There's a lot of gay sex. One of the articles I read called the film full of graphic sodomy.
You
like that phrase, graphic sodomy.
You can find this movie. If anybody can find this movie, you can find this movie.
And not only that.
And then you have to alert the masses.
He had a part in the film, and he also allowed numerous scenes to be shot in St. Anthony's Church in Phoenix, Arizona.
Okay, nice.
And I'm not exactly sure. I haven't seen the movie, so I can't tell you for an exact fact if a sex scene was in fact filmed in the church or not.
We have to find out.
But one of the newspapers in Phoenix, the Arizona Press, gave Father Saul the nickname the Porn Film Priest.
Okay.
So, in April of 2000...
If that was my title, I could die happy.
The Porn Film Priest?
If I was the porn film priest, yes. I would have been accomplished, yes.
But he had these eyes. They were very Latino heat, smolder eyes. He had smolder eyes.
And fires break out, so it's not his fault.
Yeah, it's not his fault that he has so much Latino heat. God, everybody loved Father Saul. Everybody loved him. So, in April of 2000, the second church also mysteriously burned down.
Uh-huh.
Father Saul was one of the last men in church before it burned down. Suddenly, Father Saul was the target of an investigation by the ATF. The awesome tornado flatulence.
Yeah, that's what had George Papard, Mr. T, Dirk Benedict. Yeah, the ATF.
Yeah, the ATF.
Uh-huh.
He did allegedly pass a lie detector test. I'm assuming he passed it using the smolder of his romantic Latin eyes.
Yes.
So in November of 2000, he stepped down citing exhaustion, which I personally believe stinks in the same way it stinks when a band breaks up and cites creative differences.
Yes.
So he stepped down. There are questions as to his whereabouts. Some press I read say that his whereabouts are unknown. One website I went to said that he fled to Mexico. Another one says that he is actually working as an administrator and refuses to talk about his time as a priest. So it's all a big question mark as to what happened to Father Saul, but that's important, okay? So right there, that's a pretty crazy story, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it gets crazier.
Okay.
Okay, in November...
Okay, hold that thought. I need a quick break.
Okay, yes, let's take a break. Okay. Let's take a break. We will be right back with the shocking conclusion to this week's story right after these vaguely commercial messages.
Hey guys, real important information here. I'm disarming a fucking bomb right now, but while I do that, please, please go listen to The Pope on Film. Find us in iTunes by searching for Undead Cow. And, yeah, Stitcher. It's on fucking Stitcher, too. Okay? I've got shit to worry about. Goodbye.
Thank you. was alive when I met you. Am I anymore? I should have been another time. Sure, that shows up. I was breathing when I met you. Took my breath away. And I said it, but not really anymore. And it's not so much I'm angry, I think I'm insecure. I met a thousand people like me. I was just one more. And now every time I see you, it makes me wanna cry. Follow me, get broken, crashing from the sky. And all the wells are empty, our cups have all run dry. And there's nothing left to steal from me. I've got nothing left to hide. I've got nothing left to hide.
Before we're back, I mean, this can still be in the episode, but so I'm nearing the end of my story. Do you think it's a good story?
I think it's a good story. I think it's pretty interesting.
Okay, I think it is pretty interesting. We had longer to do this podcast this week.
Yeah.
And I'm glad we did, because this allowed me to just write all this out, and I think it's an interesting story, but we're getting to the best part.
Okay, good.
We found out about Father Smolder, but we haven't learned about the other players of this story. So, in 2002, the Maricopa County police, the district attorney, the Maricopa County, which is the county that Phoenix is in, launched a grand jury investigation.
Investigation.
Do you know why I say investigating, Bella? I say investigating instead of investigating because it's a reference that I don't think anyone gets from a specific episode of Home Movies. You remember that cartoon with Brendan?
Yeah.
You remember that cartoon? It's the episode where they go to the medieval fair and Patton Oswalt plays like a Ren Faire member and he's talking to Brendan and he goes, "There's been some investigating. There be tales." So every time that I say investigating on the show, I say investigating.
Investigating.
So there was a grand jury investigation into cases of sexual abuse by priests in Phoenix, sexually abused youths. So, and the covering up of those crimes by
the Jesus Christ Superstar hater.
Yes. No. Windy Window.
Oh, that was my second.
Boogie Loves.
That was my second guess.
Adventure.
Yeah.
People would say to her, Windy Window, what do you see? And she said, decades of sexual abuse by priests that I cannot tell you about because I am covering it up. That is the tragic tale of Windy Window.
If you don't want them hearing you, then...
It is sad.
And Bishop O'Brien. So the both of them.
The both of them together? Were they lovers?
Maybe.
Okay.
But he was definitely the target of the investigation. He was the target of the investigation, not the Walmart of the investigation. He was the target. So in 2000...
And definitely not the TJ Maxx.
Oh, yeah. No way. Not the Ross.
Mm-hmm.
Every time I go to a Ross, it's like a bomb has dropped in the middle of it. And we're weeding through the wreckage of a post-apocalyptic world. That's Ross to me. So in 2003, Bishop Thomas O'Brien admitted... He was on the stand. He was on trial, and he admitted in a court of law that he repeatedly sheltered priests who sexually abused kids, and that he did, quote, everything in his power, unquote, to transfer the offending priests to different parishes where they would still be in contact with minors and the victimizations continue.
But so it was only the power of Grayskull.
The power of Grayskull?
Yes.
He admitted he was basically the first Catholic priest in a court of who to ever admit in the court of law that's like, oh yes, I have been covering all of this up. The prosecution ended when the bishop admitted that he had sheltered abusive priests, so he agreed to cede his authority.
Okay.
Over sexual abuse policy. But here's the bitch of the story right here. Okay. He admitted all of this only after reaching a plea deal that made him immune to all criminal charges.
So it didn't make a difference if he admitted it anymore.
Yeah.
He wasn't going to get into trouble.
So basically, he's just like, let's make a deal. I will tell you anything you want as long as you make sure I don't go to jail. Okay, you won't go to jail. Oh, yeah. Well, in that case, yeah, I'm a horrible person who's been covering up... child molestation for decades. Yeah. You mean to say I won't go to jail anymore? Oh yeah. Then yeah, I've been doing this for a really long time.
I was good at it. I was really, really good at it.
Yeah. You need me on that wall. He also vastly diminished his role and authority in the diocese. I believe that technically he's the bishop emeritus.
Okay.
Emeritus? So you know who had to come out of retirement to help undo all of Bishop Thomas O'Brien's damage?
Muhammad Ali?
Monsignor Moyer.
Oh.
Who had retired. And so he had to come out of retirement in order to try and make the Catholics of Phoenix not commit Harry Caray from this horrible thing that happened. And I would like to imagine that Monsignor Moyer had a press conference where he said something along the lines of, I know a lot of people are having some trust issues with the Catholic Church, especially here in Phoenix. So I thought, you know, we'd have like a little rap session. You and I, we can get together. We can talk about anything. You can ask me anything.
Yeah.
And there's one reporter in the back with his hand up going, yeah, I've got a question about masturbation. So, am I doing it wrong? I think my grip is a bit too tight.
Are you overhand or underhand? Have you ever heard of The Stranger?
That's a callback to an earlier thing I said. That's like a comedy circle of life right there.
Yes, it is.
And I think it's pretty beautiful. But here's the best part of the story, okay?
Okay.
Here's the best part of the story. Less than 2 weeks after he reached a plea deal, making him bulletproof from criminal charges in the Catholic sex scandal, he was involved, Bishop Thomas O'Brien, was involved in a hit-and-run accident that killed a 43-year-old man.
Okay.
And he had been drinking at the time. I'm not saying that this man's death is a good thing. The man's name was Jim Reed, a 43-year-old man who died. I'm just saying that I'd like to think that Bishop Thomas O'Brien is driving in his car drinking, going, "Oh, man, I reached a plea deal. I'm bulletproof. No one can arrest me now. Thunk, thunk."
Yeah.
What was that? It doesn't matter. No one can touch me.
Yeah.
And just drove away. Luckily, the driver behind him wrote down his driver's license plate number. He later claimed that he didn't report it because he thought he hit a dog, a cat, or a large rock.
Okay.
He was arrested and found guilty, but get this, this really upsets me. He was found guilty of leaving the scene of a fatal accident, and that's it.
Oh, okay.
They found there was alcohol in his system at the time. He wasn't charged with a DUI. He killed a man. He wasn't charged with killing the man. His only crime, apparently, was leaving the scene.
Yeah.
Of where he killed a man. He was sentenced to 4 years probation. And that is it. Oh, and 1,000 hours of community service. I was going to say commercial service, but I changed it. Community service, which means that he now works at Greendale Community College.
That's what I was about to say.
Oh, I thought he was doing his community service in one of the many various daycares in Arizona.
Where, one older kid accidentally beats up a younger kid. And so then he suddenly says, "Oh, let's hush this up. Here. He puts a blanket over the kid who beat up the other kid and then transfers him to a different daycare.
Yes. Exactly.
He is the first American Catholic bishop to ever be convicted of a felony.
All right. Convicted.
And he resigned as bishop in June of 2003. And I feel like if there's anyone to blame in this scenario, it's me. Because
it's you.
I knew that he was a bad guy because he hated Jesus Christ Superstar. I feel like I could have done more to stop him.
Don't blame
in his
yourself.
Reign of terror.
Reverend, don't blame yourself. How are you to know?
But that is the end of my my sordid story of crime and murder. Do you have any thoughts about that story? I think it's a good story.
Well, the immediate thought is that, you know, because again, what could you have done? I don't think not liking Jesus Christ Superstar is admissible in any court.
I also feel that Bishop Thomas O'Brien really should have had the book thrown at him.
Yeah.
And I feel that if he was a black bishop.
Do they have them?
They do in chess.
Yeah, true.
But if there was like a black leader of a church somewhere, that they would have been probably shot to death. But I really do feel that he should have had the book thrown at him. A large book. War and Peace.
Yeah.
A James Michener novel. Hawaii. Should have had the book Hawaii by James Michener thrown at him.
Stephen King hardcover.
Yes, Stephen, The Stand.
Yes.
In hardcover. That brick of a book. And it's loosely related to the podcast in the sense that, you know, the death of Richie was a story.
And this is a story.
And this is also a story. So
there we go.
Yeah, there we go. Also, one bishopaccountability.org says that one of the reason why, allegedly, the reason why the Maricopa County started the grand jury investigation about Bishop O'Brien is because Bishop O'Brien was accused in court of sheltering Father Saul, who allegedly molested a priest, molested a kid at my school.
Uh-huh.
But it wasn't my grade. It was my brother's grade. I'm pretty sure my brother knows the person. But yeah, Father Smolder.
I don't know. I don't know if I believe that Father Smolder did that. Because he had a sex life. We know he had a sex life.
That is a good point.
So why would he molest little boys? Now, he would burn down a church because he was embezzling.
Oh, I love that.
Then that's different.
Yeah.
Yeah, a lot of mysterious church burnings.
Yeah, but you can also kind of think that it's like, wait a second. I know where we could pin a lot of this.
Yeah.
That priest, the priest with the church, he's Mexican, isn't he?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Child molester. There we go.
I would be happy to report.
He is a handsome man. He's a handsome man.
Enough,
I'm just saying
enough
that because
to
it's
be,
fat.
He's handsome enough to be in gay porn.
14 ways to wear lipstick.
Yes.
I need to find this movie now. I know I need to.
I believe you need. I want to see it now. I really want to see it.
What priest, though, says, like, oh, yeah, sure, come on in. Apparently, I know for a fact that there's one scene in which a person is yelling and screaming obscenities at a statue of Jesus Christ. Now, you can do that on a set. The people watching the film don't have to know that you're doing that in an actual church.
Yeah.
But it was done in an actual church.
Well, yeah, an actual church is still going to look, especially a cathedral, you know, is going to look nicer than any set you can build. Because that's going to get pricey in the cathedral, that's free. And
yeah.
Really, really, come on. If you're a Catholic priest and you're going to bone your gay lover in the cathedral, don't tell me that's not going to make you brick fucking hard.
I will say this, though. I just going a little bit back here. I talked to a number of people, and they said, oh, hey, are you working on your podcast? I love your podcast. What movie are you doing next week? And this happened a number of times. And I said, oh, we're doing a movie called The Death of Richie. And everyone said the same thing. They said, oh, you mean La Bamba?
Yeah, that kind of surprised me.
No, it's a made-for-TV movie called The Death of Richie. Oh, is it about Richie Valens? No, it's a made-for-TV movie about a true story about a kid who was shot by his dad. A number of people said that. Every time I said Death of Richie, I heard, you know, that's what everyone put in my brain. They said, oh, you mean The Death of Richie? And when I think The Death of Richie, I think actor Isai Morales screaming for Richie.
Yeah.
I have a wonderful story about that. We went to a water park. We went to a water park in Sacramento. It's within the California State Fairgrounds. So yeah. we were at a water park. And I went there with my daughters. Just with my daughters. My wife wasn't there for some reason. Work. So it was just us. And as we're about to separate to go into like the dressing rooms to get all dressed up and everything.
Right.
They start playing the song.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Zanna, Zanna,
Hosanna,
Hosanna. Oh, sorry, what?
Love Jesus Christ Superstar. No, they start playing the song Sleepwalking by Santo and Johnny that plays at the end of...
Death of Richie?
No, not at the end of Death of Richie. That plays at the end of La Bamba. And I turned to my oldest daughter, Emerald, and I said, every time I hear this song, I just want to yell out, Richie! And she just got all embarrassed and rolled her eyes and said, Dad, please don't. And I said, I'm gonna. And she said, well, I'm gonna go get dressed. And so she walked away. And so I waited until she was far enough away that she wouldn't be embarrassed. And then as loud as I could, I yelled, Richie! But here's the best part.
Yeah.
Two other people yelled it too. From like the other side of the park, suddenly I hear a small echo of Richie! And then like 10 seconds after that, I heard another Richie! And I took that as justification.
Yeah.
I was justified by that. I'm not the only one.
That never dawned on me. Because, like, one weekend morning, just a couple of weeks ago, I wake up Saturday, Sunday, I forget what. I wake up, and I don't wake up well. Okay?
Okay.
And it was just, Jeannie found it on one of the really off Roku channels. And I wake up and I'm sitting here and I'm like, holy shit, this is a Death to Richie. So then we watched it again. And I was like, we have to do this one. And then when we were just talking like that for, you know, we were talking about what movie to do next, that just came out. And it was like, oh, yeah, we got to do this one. Especially since, like, in all your research, what you found is that this, in a period of history, was a really important film.
Yes, it was.
And now nobody has any idea what it is.
Yep. Nobody at all.
They think La Bamba.
Yep. Although, to be fair, La Bamba is an amazing movie.
I probably haven't seen it since it first came out. I love Lou Diamond Phillips, so I'm sure it is.
Yeah.
It's got to be better than Buddy Holly.
Oh, man, but there was a time when Gary Busey was respectable.
That period did not last long at all.
No, it did not. It lasted a couple seconds.
It probably peaked with the Buddy Holly story.
Yeah.
And then,
no, absolutely.
And then he kind of made his comeback in Lethal Weapon.
Yeah. Yeah.
And now in Hollywood terms, he's like the Otis. Remember Otis from the Andy Griffith Show?
Yes.
Would get drunk, come into the jail, lock himself up.
Yes.
And then let himself out in the morning. Yeah. Yeah. He's like Otis. It's like, you know, Gary Busey really sucks, but he's still kind of fun to have around.
Yeah. Has Gary Busey should team up with what's his name? He just did Nicolas Cage. Nicolas Cage. He should team up with Nicolas Cage.
And Nick Nolte.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
They could be kindred spirits.
We have a drawing.
Yes.
While I am preparing briefly, why don't you tell us a little bit about Panda Candy?
Panda Candy is my friend. She is a cam girl. Apparently, if you want a Skype show, I believe it's pronounced Skipe. Swipe. Skipe.
Skipe.
Yeah. Uh-huh. So if you want a Skipe show, get a hold of her. But she's just this cute, beautiful young girl that I accidentally met on the internet. We've been talking a lot. She's a really great person, and I like her very much. She's become a friend.
Yes.
And she's been having some financial trouble. So there is a website, the FundMe. There's a FundMe that you can go to.
GoFundMe.
Yes, GoFundMe site that she has set up if you want to help her out. It would be a very nice thing to do. And that would be awesome. Help a cam girl out. Cam girls are people too.
Yes. It's in our discussion group. It's in our page. She had asked me to pass it around, and I spammed it all over the place like I usually do. So look for us. You'll find her.
Yes. Follow us on Face on the Facey pages.
Yes. Okay, so this week's drawing. Last week, well, the first winner was Bruce Noble, who posted an amazing picture of him holding the two DVD set of Bob's 30 Shorts.
That.
So thank you very much for doing that, Bruce. That was amazing. It made me really happy to see really my work out there. You know what I mean? In a small way, it's like, okay, my work has made it in the hands of somebody in Oklahoma. And I think that's really kind of awesome. And I'm really glad that it was Bruce, because Bruce really deserved it. Our last week's winner, David Duvall, he was entered because he had liked a Bob's 30 Short ad on Google+. I have contacted him.
Oh.
I am pretty sure I contacted him. I don't know how the fuck messaging works in Google goddamn Plus.
I've never used Google+, so I do not know.
I will keep trying to get in touch with him, but at this point, he has not been able to claim his prize. But we have a half full of entries this time, and I am shaking it up. I am shaking it. Get the microphone down in there. And being radio, I could like really be shaking anything. Who knows? It's a, you know.
You're obviously shaking a bag full of cats.
But Jeannie is sitting next to me, so I'm going to have her pick one.
Okay.
I'm going to pick one. I picked one.
That's so cute. Hi, Jeannie.
And the winner is R. Beck.
The R. Beck?
The R. Beck, and I am really kind of glad it was him. Although I don't know how I'm going to contact him, because he's also on Google+. So I hope he's listening. He has liked a lot of the stuff that I put out on Google+. I don't put out as much on Google+ as I put out on Facebook, but he was entered in this contest like 6 times, this particular drawing. So I'm really glad it's R. Beck, and I hope I figure out how to contact him.
Yeah, good luck with that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. As long as it wasn't at followers for you, you know.
Yeah.
A lot of names that wind up going in the hat that you pretty much know are not going to be contactable ever.
Yeah.
You know, somebody whose name is like 3 slashes and a hashtag.
Yeah.
You know, okay.
That's also the name of my sitcom.
Yeah. Three slashes and a hashtag.
Yeah. We're going to be on ABC's this fall.
Yeah. I think it should be a, I think that should be a camper horror movie.
That's creepy.
That's good. That's a good idea. I like that.
Three slashers and a hashtag.
That'd be a good movie. That'd be a good modern day horror movie.
Yes. Yes. So next week, Troll 2?
Yes, next week, Troll 2.
Any idea for homework?
Hold on. I'm gonna ask about this. Kids, do you have any ideas for homework? Like what we should force people to watch for next week?
Yeah.
Yes, Maxwell?
Troll 2.
No, we're watching Troll 2 already, Bella.
Let's do it.
Okay, Maxwell has homework for everyone.
Maxwell has homework? Okay.
Yes, Maxwell has homework. Maxwell, come over here and explain the homework to the podcast about the airplane.
Podcast? I'm going to tell you something.
Tell over here.
Okay, I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to write a name on my page, and I'm going to make it up and play and see what happens.
Okay, so basically what Maxwell says that the homework should be this week is for you to write your name on a piece of paper and turn it into an airplane. A paper airplane, and then throw it at someone.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Preferably your mom, but at anyone, I think.
And is that available on YouTube?
I don't think it's available on YouTube. Mm. I think it's something that you'll just have to do.
Okay.
Get a piece of paper, write your name on it, fold it into an airplane, and throw it at someone. Preferably your mother.
That will be a fairly short conversation. But I'm excited about this homework.
Yeah, I'm excited too. I don't think I'll be able to throw it at my mother because she's a number of states away.
Unless it's a really big paper airplane.
I think I'll just get some paper airplanes and just throw them at Natasha. With my name on them, of course, because that's the stipulation of the homework.
Yes.
So... yeah, this will be some exciting homework. Some more
fun
physical homework.
Yes.
I like that. Yeah. Good. Fun.
It helps our audience train.
Yes, for the eventual zombie apocalypse.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm down with that. Cool.
Anything else more before wrapping it up?
Nothing that I can think of, no.
Okay.
I think this was a pretty good episode.
I think it was a good episode.
Yeah, I think so too.
And until next week, I am Bunny Williams, and with me is...
Reverend Steve, and hope to see you next week.
And daughter.
And Bella, yes. You just had to chime in, didn't you? Couldn't miss appearing on a podcast, could ya? Herbal. So, until next week, we will see you next week. Still trying to get the hang of like an end tag, like an end catchphrase.
Yeah.
We will see you next week, you godless heathens.
Look out, the lever!